Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon, fellow panelists and the rest of the world. It's a pleasure to be here in this session of the EMF. And this session is going to deal with housing for the poor and affordable housing, the India experience. To introduce myself, I'm Raj Verma. I'm former chairman and managing director of National Housing Bank. I've spent about a good 30 years in the housing and mortgage industry, and I'm currently also consulting for the World Bank Group. Mona.
Hello, good day, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here amongst you all. My name is Mona Kachwaha, and I'm an impact investor based out of India. I have spent the last 13 years approximately in the impact investing space as an equity investor. And prior to that, I was with Citibank, and a part of that experience also included working on microfinance. So I spent a total of about 15 years in this sector. In the last decade or so, I've had the opportunity to invest in a few housing finance companies focused on the affordable segment. And I'll be sharing those experiences here. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Vinod Kothari. I'm a structured finance consultant. I'm an author of a few books on securitization and one on housing finance. And I have done a few consulting projects, of which one was on affordable housing finance, which was during Mr. Verma's time in the National Housing Bank. And I'm also currently running a project on securitization of residential mortgages as a part of World Bank's short-term assignment. And I'll be very happy to talk about how housing finance in India has been assisted by the various measures of the government, including the current status of securitization. Look forward to interacting with all of you.
Thank you, Mona and Vinod. So here we are. Let me start with a very inspirational quote, which I often do, from Desmond Matthew. He's an American sociologist. And it goes as follows. A national affordable housing program is an anti-poverty effort, human capital investment program, community improvement plan, and public health initiative, all rolled into one. Unquote. So this is something which has been very, very inspiring, and add to it the growth potential of investments in housing. And housing investment as an employment generator, we have the entire recipe for a very sound, vibrant, and sustainable, inclusive growth. So with this, it almost seems that the government of India has listened to this quote, and they listened to Desmond Matthew and all that he had to say. And I'm very happy to share with you all that the housing finance system has evolved over a period of time in India to become very vibrant, very sustainable, and very inclusive. So from my perspective, I have been associated with the housing finance and the growth of the mortgage industry for nearly 30 years. And I have looked at it from various aspects. What strikes to me majorly are the following. One is, of course, which takes priority and preference over everything else, is the government policy and the program. Now, government policies don't come out of a vacuum. There has to be a sustained effort to sensitize the government to project housing as a sector that means a lot for the government, for the people, for the nation as a whole, and it has plenty to contribute to nation building. That's something which, and for that you need a champion. You need a promoter of this overall larger cause and this context. And that's what happened in India. And we have been able to very successfully sensitize the government to the need for investments in housing, to the need for investments in affordable housing particularly, and the low-income housing. And we have had a number of government policies and programs which have supported the cause of affordable housing. So policies and programs are one, which we'll talk about in greater detail as we go along. Second piece is the institution building. Well, the institution building would mean essentially reach and depth of institutions who are essentially channelizers of mortgages, the mortgage finance. And the institutions, for them to actually lend in a big way to housing, there has to be supportive regulations, supportive policies. The business has to be profitable, sustainable, and not really loss-making. So all this has happened in India. This is a story of India's growth of the housing sector and the specialized growth of specialized institutions. So this is the second piece, which is the institutional growth, that institution building, the framework and the network of institutions, which have been, which have proliferated the geographical width and breadth of the country. And today we have, as a result of that, a large number of players, the financing institutions, commercial banks, cooperative banks, regional rural banks, specialized housing finance institutions, microfinance institutions, housing microfinance mortgage institutions. So we have a whole plethora of institutional buildup, and it has happened over a period of time. We needed an apex institution for that, and that was in the form of the National Housing Bank, which was set up as a statutory body as long back as in 1987 by an Act of Parliament, which itself articulated the government's intention for driving the housing sector, as it needed that kind of a support and the direction of an apex institution. So that time on, there has been a steady and a consistent growth of the housing sector. So that was the institution building part. The third piece, which is again very important, is market infrastructure development. And the market infrastructure development essentially would mean a whole lot of legislations, regulations, rules, institutions, and products which are, you know, risk mitigations basically for the construction industry, risk mitigation for the individuals who are buying the properties, risk mitigation for the lenders who are providing mortgages. So that's the third piece, which has happened over a period of time. And we have to support that a number of measures like the Credit Guarantee Trust Fund for low-income housing, which is government-funded. And we have easy foreclosure laws, which give a lot of comfort to the lenders and the international investors as well, the equity investors and the debt lenders. So we have a whole ecosystem of financing institutions to support them, the growth of the market infrastructure pillars and the measures, which are pretty much in place now and very, very vibrant. And they have to be evolving. So there is constant dynamic around the market infrastructure piece. And the fourth, of course, which is the most important, is funding. So that's the fourth piece, and funding. So if you look at it from the government policy and program point of view, the institution building point of view, second piece, the market infrastructure point of view, the third piece, fourth being funding, all the first three pieces are essential to support funding of the sector. And that's indeed very, very important, and which would mean that there is confidence all around. We have been able to build and generate confidence amongst the investors who are investors in the equity holders in these housing finance companies, in the banks, the debt providers, the lenders to these institutions also, and all stakeholders. So we have a kind of a confidence building initiative and measure across the industry, across the entire ecosystem, to ensure that there is adequate funding of the sector and sustained flow of funds is ensured. So these are the four pieces. And on this, I think numbers, though all of you would know that for India, numbers don't mean much because we have such large scales, not in terms of geographical land area, but in terms of the population. So numbers are pretty huge. But just to give you a flavor as to how the sector has grown, if you look at it from the point of view of loans outstanding, I mean, today, for example, we have the mortgage penetration rating at just above 10% of the India's GDP. So that's, we have a long way to go still, but it has come up from 2 to 3% way back in mid-90s to as much as above 10% now in 2020. And we expect that with this kind of growth, there has been some projections on India reaching 15%, the mortgage outstanding 15% of GDP by 2022. Well, we'll keep our fingers crossed, hope for the best, and I'm sure the growth as it has been registered in the mortgage industry of about 18 to 20% year on year has been very, very commendable, and it is sustained over a period of time. Just to share some numbers, today's say loan outstanding, if we go back in time in 2000, we had in terms of US dollar, 13 billion, 2000. In 2005, it was 46 billion. In 2010, it was close to 80 billion. And after that, 10 years later, it is currently at 270 billion US dollars. So that's about 20 trillion INR. Now, this is a growth story of India in terms of tangible numbers, the volume of funds coming into the sector. And equally, this is the outstanding today. That's the size of the sectoral balance sheet. But if you look at the annual flow, annual disbursement, which is also very, very important, and that is currently in the range of about US dollar 54 to 55 billion per year, about 4 trillion INR per year, and which is huge, which is growing at about 18 to 20%. And to ensure this growth, to ensure the sustainability of growth, we have all these first three pieces, the government programs and the policies, the infrastructure development, where the banks and the housing finance companies are very bullish on retail housing loans, and particularly in the affordable housing segment. And then we have the market infrastructure, all these three supporting the quantum of funds and the quantum jump in the funds availability for the sector. Now, to give you a little flavor of affordable housing, 50% of banks' funding today is going towards loans up to 2.5 million INR. Now, that's what we call a 2,500,000 INR is the what we call a preferred sector. That is the people in the low and moderate income group who need housing. So there has been a growth in demand. There's been growth in supply of housing credit. So today we have nearly 50% of the banks lending going to for affordable housing, which is loan up to 2.5 million. Out of that, loans up to one, that is 0.1 million, is 100,000, is still 13%. And that's the real weaker section of the people. And similarly, we have this story with the housing finance companies who have developed their capacity and their skills to be able to lend to the lower segment of the population with all the support which the ecosystem is providing to them. And today we have good about 20-25 of these specialized housing finance companies who are actually contributing to the growth of the micro mortgages, the housing microfinance space, and a large number of people who are being covered in this. So we have a connectivity of the formal financing institution with the informal sector of the people who are in the informal sector, who are employed in the informal sector, whose incomes are informal, and they are certain, they are a business risk. But this risk is now very much understood, measured, and appraised by the lenders. And they take a very informed decision, and they take very informed risk. So that's where we are today, and we are on the cusp of a huge growth, I would say a big bang growth in the informal sector, and the bank's funding and the specialized housing finance companies funding to the informal sector has been growing in size, in numbers, in depth, and in geographical reach. So I'll stop here, and I'll request Mona. Mona has been engaged with the informal sector, micro mortgages, the microfinance institution, to share your thoughts and experience. Mona, it'll be a good point to have your views and thoughts on this.
Sure, Mr. Verma. Thank you for setting this up for me to step in. I think the perspective of a funder, especially an equity investor, actually builds from, you know, all the points that you mentioned. Really, that foundation has to be there and has to be very, very strong for an investor to step into a new space or even a growing space, to have the confidence that there is an ecosystem which is strong, there is an enabling environment from the regulator, from the government, and it is aligned with the priorities and the perspective of the private sector, institutions, whether it's an equity investor or a lender. So I'll just sort of underscore that part as to, you know, what gave someone like, me as part of our institution, the confidence to invest in this space and the stage at which we came in and how I see it today. I think the first thing that I would say that any investor would look at is how big is the market and is the demand addressable? In India, I think the markets are typically, the numbers are quite huge, but the addressability of that market is often questioned as to, can you really, through your product, service, processes, which is, feasible for the institution to have in place, can you really address it? I think for housing, that has never really been in question. One, because of the huge need and the gap that exists for appropriate and affordable housing for the low and middle income segments. But, going a step within that, within that framework of what that demand is, I think the most important criterion within that is that these are first-time homeowners or first-time formal homeowners who value the housing asset as nothing else in their lives. It is not just a source of, as you mentioned earlier in your quote, not only is it a source of quality life and life, it is also a source of livelihood. So the attachment to the property extremely, extremely high. So there's a huge demand, and the quality of the demand is something which is, which is something that the practitioners and the providers of capital can really plug into. The second aspect is, I think from my vantage point, as you mentioned that I have been associated with the informal customer segments through the work we've done in microfinance for a long time. Microfinance really demonstrated to us the creditworthiness of customers with informal segments. And the fact that they have been excluded from the formal financial systems because the big banks and the big lenders found it difficult to underwrite those credit, their credit, really presented an opportunity for those institutions to step in. And the microfinance experience showed all of us that if it is done the right way, if the structure of the loan program and the interaction that you have with the customers and the loan terms are appropriate, this customer segment, and when I talk about the customer segment, I mean the low income, the middle income, the lower middle income, the two, three layers of the population that don't have appropriate and affordable housing today. So the microfinance experience really demonstrated that if you have the right processes, you have the right product structures, you can meet that demand. And it's a very highly creditworthy customer segment. This is really the center of life and livelihoods, like I said. So, there was no question that at least in my mind, there was no question that the experience of lending or giving a mortgage loan, a micro mortgage loan to a customer profile that's similar to microfinance, maybe not in terms of the amount of household income and all, et cetera. Maybe it needs to be maybe perhaps slightly higher, but the characteristics, the demographics, the socioeconomic characteristics are similar. Would a micro mortgage have a similar experience in terms of credit quality? I think our going in thesis was that it would. And that is exactly what has played out. I think the third aspect that we looked at very closely was really if there's such a huge demand, the customers have the capacity to borrow if they're provided the right type of loan, where is it that they would acquire this housing from? Where will they buy? I mean, where's the supply? And that candidly has been an extremely sort of slow to meet the demand kind of part of the problem. The affordable housing supply from the developers, be it the large or the medium or the local developers, has been slow to move in and meet that gap. But you know, India, human spirit is quite strong and supreme, and I feel people have found, as in the customers and households have found, different ways to solve this problem. So if once the credit availability of credit started to flow in, we saw really a much faster increase in self-construction loans than we saw the loans going to purchase of flats through the developer community. And that's just fine as long as, you know, it's meeting the demand. We also saw an increase in home improvement loans and incremental housing, etc., but much slower in the form of loans given to for purchase of developer properties. And of course, like you said, all of this, we've assessed from time to time as an investor, when you sort of support an institution in the first round or the second round or third round of its equity raise, really, what is the environment looking like? I remember about 10 years ago or 12 years ago, there was a flurry of new entrepreneurs coming into the space. And Mr. Verma, this was in your time as the chairman, and so many of them got the confidence and the support from NHB to actually set up their institutions, capitalize them, and move forward. Candidly, a lot of times it was not very clear where the debt would come from. And I would just quickly move to Vinod to elucidate that point, because when we invested, the first couple of rounds of investment was typically supported by equity, very little visibility of debt. There was a hope that most of these institutions will get the refinance support of NHB, and that was a big part of the thesis. So the fourth part of our thesis, after addressable demand, creditworthiness, and where the housing will come from, was really what is the environment like. And even though we have a lot of questions unanswered, In the space of, let's say, debt availability to these institutions, also how the credit will play out, another part was the foreclosure norms, regulation, which is not available to everybody. You have to be a certain vintage of institution and to have received it. These were question marks some years ago. But because of the positive policy environment, because of the strong support from NHB, all of these things became possible. We saw very early stage institutions getting refinanced from NHB. There was a tweaking of priority sector lending requirements to suit the kind of debt that that the affordable housing finance companies were putting out, and to be able to raise refinance lines from banks, and SARFIC, which is the foreclosure regulation, became available to all HFCs. So I would say the last almost 12 years of this evolution has been fantastic. And you mentioned, Mr. Verma, there were 25 odd institutions who are focusing on this. Many of them remain quite small. If you look at the top 10, 12 institutions by, not just in terms of their size today, but also in terms of, how strong they are as institutions in our own assessment. Of course, these are qualitative assessments. They have grown at a CAGR of 45%, weighted average CAGR. They've grown from, in my estimation, from around 2 billion in assets to about 9 or 10 billion in assets as of a year ago. So this is a fantastic story. Most of it is micro mortgages, but there is an element of unsecured home improvement loans, etc. Which a point that I'll come back to later, because maybe I've taken too much of everyone's time here, and I'd like to maybe propose that we throw some light on the debt aspect of it, because that's a whole topic in itself.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Mona. Before we come to you, Vinod, I would like to just sort of share with all the participants one fact that there has been a complementarity of the government initiatives and the market development. So if you look at the macro level, the government has moved in tandem with the market, and it has led the market grow by itself, so that we have a a very sustainable and a vibrant sector. Government has come in very selectively, but quite effectively, into complement the market forces. And that's where many of these government programs under the Prime Minister's housing program, which was announced in 2015, of providing housing for all by 2022, with its different pillars of grant and subsidy scheme, which was announced and which is in operation today for the economically weaker section and lower income group people, to provide support to the lending institutions in a big way, by way of subsidies from the government, but routed through the lending institutions, of course, overall supervised by the National Housing Bank. So that has improved the affordability of the people. So there's been interest subsidy to the extent of 6.5% out of the interest paid to the borrower, paid by the borrower. So that clearly is a big risk mitigant for the lender. So the lenders are very enthused and they feel very comfortable with this interest subsidy scheme of such order to be able to finance those who are actually needy and in the informal sector. Similarly, we have had a number of fiscal and budgetary concessions, both on the supply side and the demand side, which Mona was talking about. Mona, you were talking about the builders and the supply coming in a slow measure to address the demand. There has been a number of government-led financial concessions through the budgetary announcements in terms of, say, for example, exemption of income tax on 100% tax on profit of the builders on the projects which they do for under the central and state government schemes, approved schemes. Similarly, we have under the Prime Minister's housing program, we have under one of the components of that, which is affordable housing in partnership. That's in partnership with the private builders, where the builders, if they do 35, at least 35% of the project is for economically weaker section, they get 150,000, the households, those units get 150,000 per person, per household from the government as grant. So these are a combination of government's fiscal benefits, government's specific programs for affordable housing, and the market filled with the lenders, both in the formal and the informal segment, that's providing the entire ecosystem for the housing industry to grow. We know they'd like to please share your thoughts on securitization, of course, and the debt aspects, as well as you're free to comment on the government schemes and the programs, and we'll come back to it later.
Right, sir. Thank you very much for allowing me to come at this juncture. And Mr. Verma talked about the building blocks of an efficient housing finance system. And he talked about the capacity building, the institutional framework, the market infrastructure. And as he was talking, he was also mentioning that for all of this, what you need is a champion. For all the participants, the champion is right here. Mr. Verma has been the champion himself of leading the fantastic growth of the housing finance sector, which is so far seen an excellent CAGR in terms of numbers. But let me start by looking at the caption for today's session. We're talking about financing for the poor, the India story. And as we note, it's a story, it's not a fable. So I cannot regard this story as a fable, a fabulous growth story, I would say. If I look at this story in international comparison, there might be, like in every story, there are twists and turns and there are shortcomings and pain points. In this story as well, there might be shortcomings. There are some institutions which are still lacking. We still do not have, for example, a securitization intermediary, which is there in many of the countries. We still do not have digitization of land records, which is one important building block for efficient housing finance system. So there are several things which are still lacking, but that's exactly the beauty of a story as it develops. We have not come to the stage where we can say we lived happily ever after. So this is still a developing story and there are still lots of things which are on there, which are work in progress. Now, let me start first by giving a quick background for the benefit of everyone, because there might be people who are not familiar with the Indian housing finance system. So the housing finance system in India consists of both banks, which are multi-line commercial banks, and specialized housing finance companies. The housing finance companies, HFCs, as we've been referring them to, take about 36 to 38% of the market share. The market share of banks versus housing finance companies has been having a zigzag story over time. over the last couple of years, the housing finance companies have been under liquidity strain, and therefore their share in overall housing finance has been reduced from upwards of 50% to now 36% lately. And within this housing finance sector, the entire spectrum consists of nearly 102 to be precise, housing finance companies as of now, which is, however, extremely polarized. There are some very big housing finance companies. Of course, the biggest is the one which is nearly taking a substantial share of the entire market, which is followed at quite some distance by the next in league. And if you take the volumes of the top three or four housing finance companies, then they are far, far higher than the remaining 96 or 97 companies put together. So what this basically means is that those smaller housing finance companies which are addressing the needs of the affordable housing finance sector, their approach to liabilities, their approach to funding is substantially different from the approach of the bigger ones. And if I look at the aggregate balance sheet of housing finance companies, we find bank finance still takes about 28% of the total liabilities. And on aggregate basis, the contribution of bonds, including bonds subscribed to by banks, is about 38%. But this story, remember, is that of the housing finance companies in the aggregate, because the share of the smaller housing finance companies, the extent of bond funding for them is less than maybe 15-20%. And then there are public deposits which are available to larger ones. The public deposits are not even available to smaller finance companies. And then we have NHB refinancing from National Housing Bank, which I think both the speakers in the past have talked about, and external commercial borrowings as a mode of funding. And to a limited extent, we have securitization and another India-specific equivalent of securitization, which is very commonly used in India, is called direct assignment. I'll talk about those. But before that, let me just quickly talk about these other modes of funding, including the funding from National Housing Bank. Refinancing from National Housing Bank, and I must say that this is something which is common in many countries. Most countries, in fact, have some kind of refinancing bodies which provide refinancing to the housing finance companies. So the National Housing Bank refinance, which is approximately 700 billion rupees right now, large part of that, 74% of that, goes to housing finance companies. And what it actually means is, while on the aggregate basis for housing finance sector, this is only 4% of the aggregate HFC balance sheet, but for the smaller housing finance companies, this eligibility and the fact that I've been sanctioned National Housing Bank refinance is extremely important, because that indicates the confidence of the apex refinancing body. Not only just the confidence, but even the cost of funding is even 100 to 150 basis points cheaper than the cost of bank finance. And lately, this refinancing can go up to 100% of the principal outstanding, which makes it a very important source of refinance for the affordable housing finance companies. As regards access to the bond market, the limitation for the affordable housing finance companies is that, A, their credit ratings are not very strong. Number two, the visibility from investors' perspective is, once again, relatively feeble, and therefore they face a difficulty in accessing bond markets, even though from a policy perspective institutional investors such as mutual funds are aggressively investing into bonds of housing finance companies. Offshore investors can also come through alternative investment funds, or they may register as foreign portfolio investors in the country. And Mr. Verma talked about the taxation fiscal measures the government has taken from the supply side. From the investor side as well, there is a concessional 5% withholding tax rate for investors investing into bonds through the foreign portfolio investor route. And 5%, I'm sure, even from global perspective, is a very, very convenient tax rate. External commercial borrowings also are permitted for all housing finance companies. And this can go at an all-in cost, which might even be 450 basis points over LIBOR. We were recently told by some of the quite small housing finance companies that now availability of external commercial borrowings to housing finance companies is quite easy. I would now turn to securitization and direct assignments. Direct assignment is a term, once again, I would like to introduce that, because global crowd may not be familiar with this term. This is an equivalent of a portfolio sale, however, done with the same discipline as in case of a securitization. So you've got a minimum seasoning requirement.
You also got a risk retention requirement, as is common in case of securitization. So by and large, the same framework as applies to securitization. However, there is no creation of a security. There's no special purpose vehicle in picture. It's a bilateral transaction between the seller and the buyer. However, this is the easy alternative to securitization, which is developed because of historical regions in India, but continues to be the most convenient way for people to do transactions in portfolios. Now, within the securitization and direct assignment, which is mostly clubbed together for statistical purposes, the growth rate has been quite very high. We have, I think, for last couple of years, got a growth rate of more than 100% in securitization volumes. But specific to the housing finance sector, this is still a very, very long way to go. Whereas in rest of the many other countries, securitization of residential mortgages is what drives volumes in the securitization space. But in India, most securitization transactions are not happening in the residential mortgage back sector. Now, there is something that the the government is currently doing to start securitization of residential mortgages. And that's a very important measure recommended by one of the committees of the RBI, Dr. Harshvardhan committee. And as we speak now, there is a project going on where the World Bank is examining the possibility of having an equivalent of a Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac type intermediary for facilitating residential mortgage transactions. Whether this would merely be a template or facilitator, or will it be an aggregator of home loan portfolios? Someone that buys and warehouses home loans and then later on securitizes the same. Those are things which probably will take shape over time. But as it stands, it's quite clear that there is a very serious effort on the part of the policymakers to have something which allows the smaller of the housing finance companies to be able to parcel out the portfolios into the capital market. So the situation is looking quite optimistic. And therefore, the story as it's unfolding, we've not reached the concluding part of the story still, but as the story unfolds, it's quite an interesting story. But I would be happy to discuss further on whatever might require further interaction. But Mr. Verma, over to you at this time.
Yeah, thanks, Vinod, for that. I think willy-nilly, we all get back to funding. And that's the crux of affordable housing as well. So we see two important aspects from my point of view. Is one is availability of long-term finance, and which is very important in a country like India, where we have affordability or lower EMIs only through either long-term funding is available, and also cost of funds. So the tenor of funds in the long term, anything 15 to 20 years, and affordable cost. Both together would really add to the affordability of home loan and the home. The pricing of loan is one side of it, the pricing of credit. The other side is pricing of the house. Now, the two together have to actually make the life easier for the people. On the pricing of the house, it's driven by whole set of different factors. Which are in the real estate industry, the indexation of pricing, the treatment of land approvals, the inefficiencies or efficiencies in the real economy, just the construction industry, technology, and all that stuff. So, to the extent that can be influenced, the price of houses, the government has done that by way of providing fiscal concessions to the builders, so that they pass on the benefit of those fiscal concessions at least partly to the people who are ultimately going to buy those properties. So there have been efforts on both sides, on the demand side by way of providing cheaper loans and long-term refinance from the National Housing Bank. That's one seminal contribution of the NHB, I would think, that we were always worried about not having a long-term debt market in the country, and also absence of securitization. So both these were actually preventing lending out by the lenders for a long period to the borrower. And that was impacting the affordability. That was impacting the EMIs and affordability. So we had to come in with a very specific design of and intention to promote long-term financing. And that's what we did through our refinance route. And not that we had access to long-term funding. other than the IFIs like the World Bank and the ADB, etc. But that part was smaller because we had to, you know, grow very fast. So we had to put our funds together in such a way that eventually we are able to roll out long-term financing schemes for the housing finance companies and the banks. Banks were initially very loath to come into housing, and there were also regulatory guidelines restricting their exposure to mortgage lending. This happened way back before the, just about when the National Housing Bank was set up. So banks were very, very conservative and were very insecure lending to the mortgages because of various unknown variables and absence of long-term funds with the banks. They were looking at it as a huge asset liability mismatch, all kinds of financial risks and credit risk which they were taking. So the regulator, also the central bank, was really not very positive or encouraging them to lend for housing, until the government came in to flag the importance of housing and availability of housing finance in the country. So we started this development of market infrastructure, which eventually got the banks on board, and they felt comfortable and confident in lending for housing. So long-term finance and cost of funds are two important aspects which were a big learning for us. And we are still at a stage, you know, where the market is evolving, and we are having a market where, you know, to the extent possible, we are providing funding for the sector, I mean, from the NHB side. And also the market is, in a way, in terms of rolling over of the funds by the HFC, where they face certain amount of risk in terms of repricing risk or interest rate risk, which at times bigger ones are able to hedge, but not the smaller and the medium ones who are actually engaged in informal sector housing. So that's still work in progress, I would think. And that's where we are having a lot of dialogue and engagement on the national level with the international financial institutions. So as to bring in long-term funding to the extent possible. Within this, I think the affordable housing market is, the size of it is just mammoth. And that's something which must excite the potential investors. As far as the risk mitigation is concerned, I think there's every possible measure to mitigate the risk in this sector. In fact, from the NHB side also, there's been a number of measures to de-risk the sector. And that was very important, which Mona talked about, the SARFAESI and the easy foreclosure. And also in terms of information availability, we have a Real Estate Regulations and Development Act, which came in 2016 and which is already implemented, that provides a lot of comfort to the borrowers, to the buyers, and to the lenders for projects. So that's one. The SARFAESI, which is an information portal for all the properties which are charged to certain loans, that's available to the entire financial world. So we have had a number of measures through which this broad information is available very transparently to the lenders. There have been credit bureaus for micro borrowers also. So all these have given a lot of comfort and confidence to the lenders. So we are, as a result of that, we are seeing a lot of traction in this market. Now we have, in fact, the work in progress or the roadmap or the direction in which the housing finance has to move is essentially now poised very well as a complementarity, as a combination, and a very judicious and balanced and healthy mix of the government's initiative and the market forces. So the market development, and somewhat not really guided by the government, it has gone on its own steam, but government has supported the market and made it more enabling, more conducive, and more supportive for low and moderate income housing. So that's where we stand today, and we are in fact very positive, and the government is very, very bullish on attracting investments from all over. In terms of the reforms in the financial sector, the capital market, the housing market, and the mortgage industry, the regulators are very alert and alive to the demands of the housing sector and the housing finance industry, and they are extremely responsive. So with that, we have seen a very good growth story of the housing finance industry, where the non-performing assets instances are very low, and it's still sub 1% or a little over 1%, I would think, where the both banks and the housing finance companies. And in terms of number of institutions, we have this sector is very well served, and particularly the regions which were unserved and underserved has now presence of a large number of institutions. The branches are very, very deeply penetrated, and they are well equipped with their skills and capability to serve the underserved and the excluded market. So we are looking at the housing story as becoming more inclusive as we go along, and sort of, you know, more expansive. And it is also connecting into the capital market and through capital market to the global funds market. As Vinod mentioned, that we have very positive sentiments and environment for attracting investments through the capital market. If the securitization market develops and it becomes vibrant, it's bound to attract more investments through the capital market. Otherwise, we have a good amount of interest from private equity firms. They have invested in a number of housing finance companies, and they have had a very good experience. They have been able to encash, and I would think that, you know, they have had a very satisfactory stint in and experience with the housing finance industry. Two challenges, of course, which I'd like to highlight here is which are still works in progress. One is on the supply side, which Mona mentioned, that the builders supply is not easily forthcoming, and that's where there's a lot of self-construction, but organized housing or organized construction of buildings for the economically weaker section and the lower income group is still to come in good measure. So that's something which is a work in progress, and there has been good interaction between the finance industry and the construction industry. So for that, we have a good forum and good platforms where constant interaction happens, and there is a good amount of mutual understanding by the construction industry of the financial constraint and of the financing industry with the construction constraints. So that's an ongoing story. And I think we have come at a stage where institutionally and product-wise, we are all very poised to for a quantum jump and a quantum leap in terms of funding for housing and improving affordability. My fellow panelists, Vinod and Mona, anything you'd like to add, please do.
Maybe I can add a couple of points there, and would probably be happy to get your inputs on that. When you talked about affordability of housing itself, it's a huge question, because affordable housing is all about, I mean, the house itself being affordable. And one piece which is still perhaps a work in progress and where more traction is required, and I would like to hear your vision on that, is rental housing. Because that's the way housing can be made affordable. I don't need to necessarily own a house if I can probably stay in a rented house. So the government moved to have a model tenancy law, which probably came in the central budget a year back. I'm not sure what's the status of that, but that's something which is most important to make housing affordable. That's one issue to be flagged. The other issue referred to the cost of home lending. And you mentioned that, well, that's also very important to bring housing finance at a cheaper cost. The element of cost basically is net interest margin added by the mortgage lender. Now, what we see basically is that despite the cost of lending being relatively higher, but the net interest margin charged by the housing finance companies itself is quite moderate, and compared to global comparisons, it's probably lower than what most housing finance companies world over retain. Perhaps the reason for that might be that the interest rate risk in India is passed on to the borrower, despite the fact that the housing finance company would be better in the position to absorb the risk. But most of the home loans are at a floating interest rate, thereby the entire risk gets transferred to the borrower. The cult of fixed rate mortgage lending is something which is not caught up. And probably that's also an area where more action is required, because it's probably the housing finance company better in a position to hedge and manage the risk than the borrower. These are a couple of points I wanted to add, sir. But there is a question on the panel on the screen, which is, I think, to be answered by you. which says there's a national guarantee fund existing in India. How successful was this fund? How successfully was it used by financial institutions? That's a question from Mr. Ari Ariwao.
Yeah, just to answer the question first, we appreciate the question and your interest in the Indian industry. There was fund set up for guaranteeing the default from the potential borrowers with loans up to 500,000 was the original. Now it's gone up to 800,000 rupees loan for a house. The default would be covered by the guarantee fund, which was a setup way back, I remember, in 2012-13 when I was heading the National Housing Bank. And this fund is contributed by the Ministry of Housing. There are a large number of members. All the banks and the housing finance companies have joined this fund. And it is doing extremely well, but to the extent the lenders and the borrowers, they are able to provide loans, low ticket loans of up to 500,000, now gone up to 800,000, they will be eligible for guarantee cover from the fund. The fund is fairly well sized, and the government can contribute any amount there. But I don't think it has been very popular because of a lot of moving pieces. We have the Prime Minister's housing program, which provides credit subsidy, the interest subsidy of 6.5% to 4%. That somehow has not been allowed to combine with the credit guarantee trust fund, which is coming in the way. Actually, it amount to double benefit for the lenders and for the borrowers. So there is some work in progress on that from the government side to ensure that to see how best both the products can be, whether they can be packaged together or they have to kept apart from each other. But that is something which is still, I would think that it's still not, it's not become very popular, but that's something which has to be operating. So credit guarantee trust fund for low-income housing, it's important for the lenders also. And if you have to have something like this in your country, for the lenders, it provides 0% risk weight on capital provisioning. So it's a huge cost advantage. It's a huge, it's like sovereign guarantee, where the borrowers are not supposed to provide capital against that. It's 0% risk weight. And it's a credit default guarantee. It's a cover for the potential default, and which normally can be very high in low ticket size, say up to 100,000, 200,000. The default can be high, and the fund actually covers that. So this is still work in progress. The government has been very keen to see how best it can be combined with the other schemes which have been announced by the Prime Minister housing program. We call it PMAY. So I don't know to what extent I've been able to answer, but this is something which has caught the imagination of the lenders. And the moment this gets sorted out, I'm sure we'll have a very good pickup. Vinod, coming to your point on the rental housing, yes, I saw that. It's actually the problem with housing is that it's very complex. The sector is actually within the state government's domain. So central government can lay down certain policies like RER, Real Estate Regulatory and Development Act. Each state government has to enact that legislation based on certain model guidelines issued by the government. Similarly, on the rental housing policy also, not the policy, the Tenancy Act, where the state governments have to promulgate that act based on the guidelines of the government of India. So some state governments could do that. I'm not sure how many have done it. I don't see many have done that because still at a stage where some details are work in progress. But it's a good beginning. We have been talking about rental housing for a long time, and we looked at all possible permutation combination of the employer-led rental housing for their workers, the corporate-led rental housing in their industry premises, the government-led rental housing, and the beneficiary-led rental housing. So all these have been tried, and different state governments have adopted different measures. But today's time, it becomes so important that at least for the lowest segment of the population, where there's migrant population in certain states and who are moving population, there is need to have a rental housing supply in a big way. So that's Tenancy Act and the rental housing policy, both together are going to form a good background and a platform for development of rental housing. And to that extent, we have, I mean, this is a landlord, a very balanced tenancy act, which I saw, the balancing the interest of the land owner, of the house owner and the tenant, and providing a kind of a formal mechanism of their contracting, of their dispute resolution through arbitration, etc. So it provides a very good formal framework for resolving many issues, which in today's market, the landowners, the house owners, very uncertain about. As a result of that, a huge number of properties are constructed, but remain vacant. As a result, you know, there's so much capital is locked up, so many housing units are locked up, neither available to the landowner nor to the tenant. It's just sort of, it's stuck. So all this will unlock those properties. And as we go along, let's see how the state governments respond by coming with their own legislations. So we are there now. I think we have just about touched 4:30. I mean, 1 hour we have completed. So I'm sure there would be a good takeaway from this, and the housing finance scenario is still unfolding. And as I said earlier, we are at the cusp of very huge growth, and we have all the elements in place. They have been operating very successfully, and we've had a very good run so far. And as we move forward, we are hoping for the best. And under the Prime Minister's housing program of affordable housing for all by 2022, we wish the very best to the nation. And we think that the housing finance would come up to speed with all this vision in mind. Thank you very much, all of you. And we are at the close of the session. All the participants, and this, we don't have any more questions, right? No, yeah. So thank you very much. And we are closing this session. I wish you all the very best.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you, Mr. Verma.
Thank you, Mona.
Thank you, Vinod.
Thank you all for having stayed with us so far. It's time for a little break. Maybe you want to stretch out your legs, go for a walk. We'll be back in 15 minutes.